Oh, this is Big Wednesday. I love Wednesday. Wednesday, Wednesday, Wednesday. Wednesday is the evening in which we go deep into the Word. People who participate in watching Wednesdays, I just love them because they love the Word of God. And tonight, we continue what started last Wednesday night when we talked about there is always a moment of groaning in life to go to the next level. And tonight we'll be talking about right before anything happens in life, there is a spirit of travail. Now, when I say travail, immediately say that's crisis, that's pain, and that's true. But things get real quiet before the water breaks on a woman when she's about to give birth to a baby. Everything kind of slows down. She's not as active. She can't run, jump in the car, go on a date. She can't go shopping. Everything kind of slows down. And when the next level of your life, that God's about to do something, you feel like, where am I? Things are slow. Nothing's opening. That's a good signal. We're going to talk about that. We're going to give you a word. And this is going to catapult your thinking and faith. Because this is the season, especially next Wednesday night, Ash Wednesday, that as we march into the 50 days, this is the most precious time in which God is about to bring resurrection through His Son, Jesus Christ, into your life. Tonight's going to be great, 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 great. And of course, next Wednesday night is a date with God. Didn't know that Ash Wednesday would be on the 14th of February. And so I just want to tell you, we're going to heart God next Wednesday night. And it's going to be absolutely fabulous, as that will be the first night. The cross will come down, and we will put our request, and we will start that 50-day journey. And we are going to have a move of God and Jesus of Nazareth and Palm Sunday and Resurrection Sunday. Here we are going to experience the greatest season that could ever be given to mankind. I'm excited about tonight's service. So welcome everybody, Austin, Texas, you that are in Tennessee, you that are in Missouri. I'm not gonna be able to call everybody state out there in the Appalachians, you in New York, even in California. So many of you, Chicago, Wisconsin, and the list goes on how you are so dedicated to be here. I promise you, as last Wednesday night, there were miracles that happened. Tonight, it's going to be the same way. I'm just real excited. So let's go into the service. We'll have some worship. I'm going to go right into this special word because I believe it's going to advance your faith. It's going to advance your favor. It's going to advance you believing for what is about to happen in the next 50 days of your life. Welcome to Family Christian Center. Let's go in and turn the volume up and let's worship because we're going to pray. Worship, and then we are going to bring the special word and pray especially for you. God bless you, and thank you for coming and watching Wednesday night at Family Christian Center.
Three are in the room, and there is faith for something new. We know that you're right here in the midst. Your presence is available, your promise is attainable. Possibilities are limitless. The possibilities are limitless. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Can I get an amen?
Say your promise, we'll say yes and amen.
Hey, can I get an amen?
Amen.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Oh,
when you say your promise, we'll say yes and amen. Tonight we're going to sing a new song, church, and we're going to join creation to worship the holiest. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. We sing this together.
A thousand generations are falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us, and all who will believe, will sing the song of ages to the Lamb.
We sing your name.
Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy. Holy forever. If you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, come sing the song of angels to the Lamb.
Oh, we sing.
If you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, we'll sing the song.
Your name is the greatest. Your
positions, your name stands above them all. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All throne
and dominion
all be bound to your Lord.
And position,
your name stands above.
Of our God. And the Bible says when Moses approached the burning bush, God said to him, take your shoes off, because this is holy ground. Now, I'm not asking you to kick your shoes off, but when you're on holy ground, it demands a response. We're on holy ground tonight, church. Can we respond? Can we just lift up our hands and surrender? Can we sing this out together? We sing your name.
Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name, it stands above.
All praise to you, Lord. All praise to you.
All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name stands above them. Whoa!
Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, and we worship you, Lord, that we have an atmosphere of worship today. Lord, and we come, O Lord, O Father, in prayer, O Lord, ready to decree our third John, O Lord, today, O Lord. So as we look towards the screens, we just want to declare your word, O Lord, and it tells us, repeat after me, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prosper. I want to focus in right now on the finances, on prosperity. There's some in this room right now, and those that are watching and streaming, connect your faith with me. Lord, we seek you right now, O Father God. And we know when we seek you, O Lord, we will lack no good thing, O Father. Lord, so you're going to satisfy those, O Lord, that are in need right now, O Lord. Lord, you're going to meet, O Father God, O Lord, their financial needs, O Lord. We speak to debt, O Father, right now that is canceled. Lord, we speak increase, O Father. Lord, you're paying, O Lord, O Father, and dealing, O Lord, with bankruptcy, O Lord. Lord, you're dealing with contracts right now, O Lord. We're focusing in, O Father God, that you will satisfy them, O Lord, Father, with the good things, O Lord, and the benefits, O Father, that your treasures will come upon them, O Lord. Lord, you will meet supernaturally and supply every need, O Father, that is before you right now, O Lord. Lord, O Father, bills are being met, O Father. Contracts are being signed, O Lord. Lord, you're giving promotions right now, O Father. You're touching every need, O Lord, in this room. And we thank you, Lord, and we give you all the honor, the glory, and the praise. And we receive the double portion upon our lives. In Jesus' mighty name, we say amen.
Jesus' name. I declare everybody under the sound of my voice, you are healed. No weapon formed against you will ever be able to prosper. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name is above every name. It's above cancer, heart disease, high blood pressure, low blood pressure. In the name that's above every name, I command healing in this house and those online. Receive it. I dare you to start praising God for it. That's the key. In Jesus' name, it's done.
I have the privilege of praying for our soul, which encompasses our minds, our will, and our emotions. And I just want to speak Jesus over our minds. I want to speak Jesus over our health. I want to speak Jesus over our emotions. In Jesus' name, I decree and declare that our mind, we have a clear thoughts, and our mind is blessed. And we have, our will is God's will. In Jesus' name, amen. You may sit down. Turn to your neighbor and say, thank God it's Wednesday, and look to our screen.
Excited to announce that the Forever I Am Women's Ministry is hosting our annual Women's Prayer Night, February 16th. Doors open at 6 p.m. At 6:30, we'll begin worship, and at 7 p.m., we'll begin praying together. We are so excited. We're so expectant. The theme is When Women Pray. Please bring your friends, your sister, your mom, your daughters. It's going to be an amazing night. We're so excited to see you.
Amen. Ash Wednesday is going to be next week. When we talk about Ash Wednesday, we talk about we as Christians, we were not going to do what Catholics do, but I do honor the fact that they are making an effort for the 50 days, which is from Ash Wednesday till the resurrection or Easter Sunday, as they put ash on their foreheads. And many of you probably have seen that on neighbors and people at the workplace, etc. It's a sign in which that they are going to give something up in the Lent season. Well, we have decided not to put ash for mourning, but to put oil on you. And so you will be anointed. Every person next week will be anointed with oil. Oil to believe that in the next 50 days that there is a spirit of resurrection upon you, that whatever may be dead in your life, it will be resurrected with the power of the anointing. You will be anointed, specially anointed. You'll be given, is our tradition here, a red nail. Everyone will be given a red nail to remind us what he did at Calvary. Then we will cut up purple cloths, and thank God for those that are faithful to do that. It is done so neatly and is so precisely. I wish you could see how they cut the material of the purple cloth. And those purple cloths are then dipped into oil, anointing oil. We pray for those cloths. That will be given to every person, a nail and then the purple cloth. And then there will be not only the anointing that you will receive, but the cross for the first time will be let down. And it is let down every Wednesday until Easter. We put our needs, our prayer requests upon that. Tonight you have all been passed out a purple card, and it will join in with the other cards and television and also those that are watching online to get your name in. So that we pray for the next 50 days, the next 40 days, that we are believing that what is ever on the cross, there is going to be that prayer that is going to be answered. And everybody say amen. Now, the whole world with Christians and Catholicism, which both believe that Jesus died for them, both believe in the virgin birth, which is about 3.2 billion on this planet. And they will be admonishing Wednesday. They will be honoring Wednesday as Ash Wednesday. So I want us, and I know and notice that it has come on February 14th, which is early this year because Easter is early. It is the last Sunday of March. It's the last Sunday of March. Usually it's in April, and so Easter is maybe a week or two later, sometimes 3 weeks later. Sometimes it's at the end of April, but it is early, so that makes Ash Wednesday on February 14th, which happens to be what they say, Love Day, Valentine's Day, Rose Day, and all of you that are planning to go on a date on Wednesday night on Ash Wednesday, I just want to tell you, you will be paying double when you take her out. Because in most restaurants, they increase the menu. Now, for you that have never taken out your wife or your girlfriend, you don't know a thing I'm talking about. But usually, if you go to a fine restaurant, they give you a menu and they raise the prices that are not normal. So here's the deal. Come and make a heart for God. Take your bride, your girlfriend, or whatever on Friday night, and you won't have to pay as much. Hello. And then for some of you that are tired and don't do anything for your wife or your husband on Valentine's Day, you have the excuse, we're going to go to church tonight on Ash Wednesday. But we're going to turn this around, and we're going to make it in a heart for God. We're going to make him our Valentine, if I can say that. And we are going to proclaim, and I am encouraging you that you could go on a date Friday night, Thursday night, or Tuesday night, but Wednesday night, it happens to be February 14th, we're going to have incredible Ash Wednesday, and it's going to be phenomenal, And I just can't get over it, because every Ash Wednesday is always full of expectancy. But as we invite, tell others and our families, etc., it is a night in which we do the demonstration of the purple cloth, the choir, and the musicians. We take it up a level. We are on the crusade to lift up the mighty cross of Jesus Christ. Anybody ready for the great season or the preaching of the cross? Now, before I give you this word tonight that will, I pray, enhance your faith, move you a little further, and maybe this word will get you a little quicker to your miracle, I want to talk about Jesus of Nazareth, because it's almost 2.5 weeks away. Practice is going good, and last night we were in rehearsal, and Saturdays, and all the rehearsals that we're doing. And so, to get the word out, and we're doing our best we possibly can to get the printed page out, to get the social media out. So I want everybody here to get ready to do something. I want you to get ready to do something, but I want you to see this commercial that was made by our people about Jesus of Nazareth. Can we see that first? Just a minute. Get the sound right, and we'll get the lights off.
I am the resurrection, and I am the life. Father, open their eyes so that they may see your glory.
Believe in God, and believe also in me.
Okay, it was pretty good. They didn't have the sound right and the lights off, but you get the gist of it there. So here's what I want you to do. I'm going to play another one, and these are commercials. So what I want you to do is, all you have to do is get your phone out and take a picture of this, you know, whatever they call that new technology thing. You know it. I don't, but you know it. I take a picture of it. The reason why, that video will go to your phone. You can then text it, or you can email it to somebody else. That very video right there. Not only that, but it will take you into the gallery of Refuge Productions, and you get the still shots of Jesus of Nazareth. Let's play the next video. Try to get the lights out and try to have the sound out, please. Ready? Go. That was very good. So take a picture. They're gonna take about, take a picture of that. Everybody get your phones out, take a picture of that. And that'll take you right into, you get both of those videos, put it on your phone. And there's also the gallery. I won't show you that, but there's a gallery of pictures of Jesus of Nazareth. And take a picture of that. That will load down those videos. Let me tell you, there's nothing like sharing with your friends when they ask you the question, where is that playing? What movie theater, and where's that playing? And you're able to say, that's at my church. Anybody excited about promoting your church? So you could send this as many times and everywhere. Just send them to your brother, your sister, your friends. I mean, just send it. Just send it. Say, this is what's happening. And encourage them to send it. And it will just spread. And we can get the word out. We've never done this before. I wanted to do it tonight for all of you. So everybody, you know, get it on your phone. I was wanting to give somebody the video, and I couldn't get it on my phone. So today I said, how do we do this? And so I got it on my phone so that I could press the video and send it to people. And when I'm talking to people, they kind of look at me, yeah. And I want to tell everybody something here. Last night we were in discussion at the production, and I was in discussion with one of the actors, and he was saying, he was saying to somebody, you ought to come and see this play at my church. And the person said, yeah, well, if I have time, maybe we can do it. But they did come. They came last year. And when they sat down, they said at first, they said, quite a crowd here. I mean, because it was filled, you know, sold out. And they thought they were coming to a play at a church. A little play where people make mistakes and the crowns fall off and people trip and the robes are crooked and somebody forgets their line. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, there were rockets over their head and flying angels and camels went by and there was 400 or 500 people that were in motion in costumes. And before you know it, he said, he said about 10 minutes into it, because he was invited and he thought it would be cute to appease his friend to come to a church play. And he said, about 15 minutes into what I was invited to a church play, I said, this is no church play. This is, and he was trying to explain, this is Broadway. This is Academy. So let me help all of you. Because when you tell somebody, would you like to come and see the play at my church? They're thinking the robes, they've got a bathrobe and they put it on and somebody is going to, and when you tell them animals, they don't get it. Now, there's no real animals. They probably got paper mache heads of horses and, you know, it's a cute little thing. I never say play because people just can't equate anything, presentation-wide from the church because the world thinks the church is they can't do anything right. They don't have, the ability to do Grammys and Oscars and productions, etc. So here's what I would suggest to you. You say you need to come and see this production, this Broadway production that happens to be at Family Christian Center Auditorium. Don't say church. Leave church out and leave play out. The minute you say church, they're not coming. But you say you got to come and see this show. Use the word show. Use this word production. And don't say church yet. Just say it's at the FCC Auditorium in Munster. And you'll never believe it because it's almost a 200-foot stage, three stories of sets. There's a swimming pool on it. Now you got them coming. I mean, you got them really and say, hey, here, let me put this on the phone. Then you show them that advertisement and they'll say, now, where is this? It's in Munster. And then you drop the bomb on them. It's at my church. And then they'll look at you and say, what kind of church you go to? This is at a church? Are you sure? Then when they come, they will tell you after the show, after the production, where did these people come from? These people, did you guys fly these people in from LA and New York and these children? Who are these people? Then you begin to tell them, no, these are all local people in the community and these are people from our church. The credibility that when they leave, they will look at you on your job or in your neighborhood or as a relative and say, wow, you go to some kind of church. Come on, fire up, everybody. That's what I'm going to do. This is a piece of art. We're not normal here. We don't do anything normal. You want a normal church? There's a bunch of them you just passed tonight. And they're really normal. Most of them are boring, I'm sure. But the fact is that the gospel should be electrifying. We should make Jesus and its presentation the very best. And all of you that have seen Jesus of Nazareth, the opening has completely changed. And what we're doing to the set is magnificent. And when you see, I'm not going to tell you because it'll be a big surprise, but when you see the changes that we made for Jesus of Nazareth, it will bring an inspiration of a level of appreciation of how we keep getting better and better preaching the cross. And this is a form of preaching the cross. So I want you to be a part. I want you to get a reward. One of the reasons I've been driven all of my life to do this is that the fact that I've been driven to do these things, to these stage performance and illustrations and to do Hotel Hallelujah and Scrooge, etc. The only reason why is because all of it is bait. It's bait. We don't eat bait. We eat the fish that we catch with the bait. And when you were saved, Jesus says, I will make you fishers of men. The vision of this house is to make you look good when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ. You want someday when you stand at the judgment seat of Christ, you want these words to be said which are written in the Bible, thou good and faithful servant. And you want him to say, I am so proud of you because you told my story. You fed the poor, you clothed the naked, you did the prison, et cetera, what we do here. And the fact is, it is much easier just to go through the preaching methodology and just go through the tradition ways. But this is all about your children, you, ushers, traffic control, getting on your phone and advertising it. The minute that you get involved to promoting or lifting up the cross or lifting up Jesus, you get all of the benefits just as the actors do and behind the scenes. And every person that raises their hand or comes to the altar and gives their life to Jesus Christ, it goes on your record. Do you understand what I'm saying? In other words, the Bible said, he that winneth souls is wise. In other words, the Lord did not save you to keep your mouth shut and just come to church and be a churchgoer. He saved you so that you would be a witness to other people. That's the key. That's the key. And the key is that when you participate, whether it's nailing a nail in the set, whether it's vacuuming the carpet, whether it's washing a window, whether it's an usher, a hostess, or a concession stand person, whether it's a wig person, or whether it's a makeup artist, or whether it's dealing with costumes, or whether it's cleaning the bathrooms, or whether it's hosting, or whether it's taking tickets, all of it is just as important as the role of Jesus being played, or by a soldier, or by an animal caretaker, or even if you're in animal ministry, because already there's over, I'm not sure on the exact number, but there's somewhere around 1,000 to 1,200 people that are involved upon stage and behind stage. And the person that stuffs the envelopes, the person that does everything that is connected to the kingdom, we are all lifting Jesus up on the cross and we are preaching him. Amen? This is why we do what we do. We don't do it for money because we don't get enough of it. You hear me? You hear me? We don't get enough of it. Trust me. We don't get enough of it. And we are so afraid. We shouldn't be fear-driven, but because we use the word play and church, people do not feel to pay more than $20 or $25 or $17. And I don't feel bad about going to a Beyonce concert and paying $300. They don't feel bad to go to some event that costs $200. But the church to literally take a ticket and pay $20 to come to a church and to see Jesus? No, can't do that. And so we're lopsided in the fact it would be wonderful if we could be like downtown Chicago or New York in Broadway, that their tickets start out at $125, $150. And let me tell you, go anywhere you want to go in the United States on any Broadway show and let them do the gospel of Jesus or do Jesus Superstar or whatever. And I will tell you that we as a group of people, we do this show and the story of Jesus second to none, that nobody can match what we do. And I'm not saying that to brag. I am saying because we do it with the best of our ability, with all the creativeness that we have, so that the youngest child to the oldest adult will be moved by the story of Jesus of Nazareth. And all of you that have seen it, let's give the Lord a great big hand if you're excited about Jesus of Nazareth. I am. Thank you. So let's all soul win. This is our season. This is the time in which everybody should be involved. Involved. What can I do? What can I clean? What can I help with, et cetera, et cetera. Tonight, I want to talk about tonight. And, oh, by the way, I have my new T-shirt from the bookstore. Look at that. 50. And they normally cost $45 a piece, which are worth it. But for you, it's a measly $8. Notice nobody clapped on 45, but boy, oh man, $8, I think I can do that. You better get one tonight before you leave and have fun. They're historic, 50 years, they're great, so doing that. And they're doing something with, I'll tell you about at the end of the service for those of you who have been contacted. I want to talk about continuing a little bit of what I said last week, because in this season of what is going on in the earth and what is going on in Israel and what is happening with all of us in the body of Christ and in the world. And I want to talk about, last week I talked about a moment of groaning. And tonight I want to talk about nothing happens good in your life until there is a moment of travail. Nothing. And all of you that are trying to get a free ride to be rich or to be wealthy or to have a business or to be successful will not come without a moment of travail. And all of you that want good health and all of you that want to be better in life, it will not come without travail. And everybody wants to go to the top and everybody wants to be in a place in which there is success and arrival. And I'm in a place, whether it's spiritually or whether it's physically, let me remind you that when travail happens, it's not bad, it's good. So let me read from you the book of Isaiah, where God talks about this. God tells us about things that happen in our life, and he uses Israel, and he says in the 66th chapter, he says in the sixth verse, a voice of noise from the city, a voice from the temple, a voice that the Lord doth render recompense to his enemies. And he goes on to say, before she travailed, she brought forth. Before her pain came, she was delivered. O man, child of a man, child. Next verse, who hath heard such a thing? Who ever heard of a woman giving birth without travail? This is what the Lord is saying. Who has ever heard of such a thing? Who hath seen such a thing? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day? Or shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion, when you see Zion in the Old Testament, it usually is referring to Israel, but it really is referring to the church in the New Testament, because that's where the Holy Spirit fell, is on the hill of Zion. And so Zion could actually, you could replace the church there, but the church hadn't been born yet. But for as soon as Zion, or I'm going to use the church there, if you don't mind, with Zion, as soon as the church or the people of God travailed, she brought forth her children. Now, this is important. This is God talking. He goes to the ninth verse, and he says, shall I bring to the earth and not cause to bring forth, saith the Lord, shall I not cause to bring forth and shut the womb, saith God. And next verse says, in the 10th verse, he goes on and says, rejoice ye with Jerusalem and be glad with her, all ye that love her, rejoice for joy with her, all ye that mourn for her. And then he goes on in the 11th verse and he says, that ye may suck and be satisfied with the breast of her consolations, that ye may milk out and be delighted with the abundance of her glory. He goes on in the 12th verse and says, for thus saith the Lord, behold, will I extend peace to her like a river, and the glory of the Gentiles like a flowing stream. Then shall ye suck, ye shall be born upon her sides and be dangled upon her knees. Here's what God is saying. God is saying these words. Nothing happens without travail. There'll be no joy. There'll be no dancing. There'll be no, he talks about there'll be no milk. A woman who gives birth to a child, the milk comes when the child is either born or right at birth when the water breaks. Now, we men, we don't know a lot about it. We've heard the scream, the yell, the description. Some of us have been in the room with the child being born. Some of us out of the room. But every woman that has given birth to a child in here and watching me can tell you that there is pain involved. I just need a few women just to kind of verify that. And he is, God is teaching us and telling us, he says, I want you to know that nothing is born in one day. Nothing just happens. God is putting a law or putting preparation of wisdom within us, telling us that before something great happens, and then when you begin to read on, you begin to find out that after the child is born, the mother that's screaming, sweating, just going into strains, into pain to get this child out of her womb, the Bible says, and it is true, that after the child is born and the mother that's given birth to the child, when she sees the child, she forgets about her travail. Okay? But I want to propose to you tonight through the Word of God that you forget your travail only because of what you've given birth to, but you don't appreciate the child unless there was a travail. You didn't get that. Maybe I didn't explain that right. In other words, you won't take care of it. You won't give of your body, in the lady's view, of your body, which in the old country, now I know that formula is made and there's 25 bottles waiting for you to get home after the hospital, and the food is already made, and sometimes the mother does not give of her body the milk. But the fact is, in the old days, they didn't have formula, and there was no such thing as bottles. And the only way the child could exist and live was off of the mother's milk. And the fact is that even though that her body gave, she just kept giving. She wanted to give. She was delighted to give. She wanted her body to produce the milk, even though it may have taken weight off of her and having inconvenience. Listen to this: inconvenience. It's inconvenient. I mean, when all of you women who had children, all the women in here that's ever had a child, say amen. Amen. There's a big group here that's had children. They all can give their descriptions of the pain that was involved. And the fact is that she, because she travailed, she wants to care for this child. And she will give of this child, and she will fight for this child, and she will change its diapers. But if the child was handed to her, there would be a total different attitude toward that which was given. Now, I know that there's adoption. I know that in foster care living, I know that there is a gravitational pull to a baby that's given to a family or to a lady, and she begins to develop that love for the child and acts like any other mother. But you will find in that foster and in that situation that there's still something missing, and it was travail. And that travail situation is what brings real appreciation. That travail really makes you appreciate. And let me do it this way. You know, the person that works very, very hard for their money and pays for their house and pays for their car, they take care of their house and they take care of their car. Just saying. A person that rents, a person that's never owned anything, a person that doesn't have papers on ownership and never had to sweat, and it's easy because you treat an apartment different than you treat your house. Because when it's somebody else's property and you didn't have to travail, you don't treat it right. Easy come, easy go. Anything that comes easy in your life will go. Well, let me say that again. Anything that comes easy will go. When people, let me explain it this way so that you're out of the, in case you're in the doghouse on any of this, we'll get you out. When we do free stuff here, and many times we will do free, you know, stuff with Hotel Hallelujah, and in the past we've done free things for Jesus of Nazareth, and most of the crowd is free because we have given out tickets. Those people that come, free crowd, they mess this church up terrible. They spill the popcorn, they spill stuff everywhere. They use more toilet paper than anybody else. I'm just telling you now. They will get up before the show is over with and they will exit. They have no appreciation for something free. The paid crowd that comes here, that pays high dollars for 15 or 20, it may be a little messed up, but usually only messed up where somebody's free and they're among people who have respect. Because when you pay for something, you don't walk out when Jesus flies over. You're there for the whole thing. And I can always tell the freebies, they get up and they leave. They didn't have to travail paying $15, $20. They didn't have to give their money. They didn't have to put it on their card. And for all of you that live on welfare, you have no appreciation for our government because you're the first one to scream against it when you don't like what it's doing because it's free. You never had to travail. You didn't like that. I must have a bunch of people here on. You want everything free. You want everything to be easy. You'll make any issues to get around travail. But travail is actually incredible. Things slow down in travail. Let's use the woman. She's a week away, 3 weeks away, 5 weeks away. For some women, they grow very large even before the ninth month. She used to be able to put on a dress and go out on a date and dance with her man. She can't dance now. Nor can she put on the size 8. I'm helping you ladies here now. I wouldn't dare put an oversized gown on anybody. An 8 or a 10. I'm not going any higher than a 10. A 10 dress in which you can throw on and just go out and get a Coke. Things slow down. Listen to me now. Listen to this word. Things slow down. You can't go out. You can't. In fact, you dislike people for so long because you feel irritable. You're in a season of travail. Things, you don't sound right, do right. It's hard. You can't cook. Everything kind of goes into slow motion, and you get to the point that you want it over with. Come on, women, help me now. I mean, you're looking at the calendar. It's the ninth month, and this thing is still there. And you love it, and you want to have it, but it's time for you to come out. And you're waiting for the water to break. And the doctor says you got to walk. And you walk until you can't stand walking. And you can't stand. And finally you stand up and you look at your man and say, you did this to me. And he is chewed upon and ridiculed and barked at and do this and do that. And your whole personality changes. Help me, ladies. Help me, ladies. I know we live in a generation. I know we live in a generation. A man just gets a woman pregnant and then he's not around. He leaves her. He don't have to do anything. Isn't it interesting in the Grammy Awards this year that all categories of the Grammys, women won? Isn't it also interesting that every song that she won for, listen closely to the words, it's about how she was hurt by a man. And that every female that represented in the world in the Grammys was telling us there's no more men because men don't know how to treat women because we've got a generation that don't even know how to open up a car, don't know how to treat a woman, but they are professional sex maniacs. Because they know a rap song to tell you to take your clothes off and how you dance, and that's what love is all about. And baby, you don't have to carry it, kill it. I'll take to a doctor, and he will reach up into your womb and suck out that which is in your body. And put it down a drain. Which, by the way, if you get saved, you'll see that baby in heaven. Whether you killed him at 6 weeks or 10 weeks or 5 weeks of whatever you did. And because, watch this, because the girl or the woman can easily slip in and have an abortion because she doesn't have to give birth to it, she'll do it again because there's no travail. Because when there's no travail, you keep the same cycle of stealing, taking advantage, complaining, griping. Why isn't it happening to me? Why doesn't this happen? Except nothing happens in life for the good unless there is travail. And so all the songs are about men they've been hurt by. One of them, Miley Cyrus, I don't need you to bring, I know some of these words, I don't need you to bring me flowers. I can hold my own hand. What is she saying? You dumped me. You had an affair on me. And I've read some subtitles on that song and understand what the story was. She wrote the song actually to chew the guy out because he had affairs. You know what she did? I read she made the video in the house he had an affair with. In fact, she wrote the song and made all this video. She could care less about her fans. She was sending him a message. But the truth of the matter of it is, millions have the same thing happening to them. Millions of women. And you know what? Listen to this, parents, grandparents. Girls, young girls, women can't find a man because we haven't taught them how to respect a woman's body. We haven't taught them they're not whores and an object in which you just have pleasure upon. I'm not getting too many amens, are y'all? What's wrong with y'all? We should go back to the old country because it worked that way. That parents picked out for their kids. You're good enough. You're good enough. And then the male had to, in the old country, this wasn't too long ago, had to pay the parents for the daughter. And in still some countries today, in Nigeria, other places in the world, they still are doing that, that you have to pay thousands and thousands of dollars travail. And they tell me that the guy that pays for in the world, their world, the woman, there's no divorce, there's no problem because he had to travail. And if we would teach our young men to travail and not jump in bed with a woman, but travail to love her, to honor her, to appreciate her. I wish I could get some more hand claps here. But we skipped that part. We don't want travail. We don't want anything hard. We want it easy. We want it easy as we can in life. I'm going to tell you, God is telling us, the world was informed in one day. Even God travailed. Even though he spoke it into existence, between Genesis 1 and 2, there is billions of years. That's why they say fossils are billions of years old. Between Genesis 1 and 2, there are billions of years. There was a travail in the heavenlies, and God was somehow in a spirit travail, carrying something that was in him called the Yellowstone Mountains and the rivers and the Great Lakes and the glaciers and the continents and the ocean. He was carrying it. Is that but God spoke it into existence? He's telling you in Isaiah, it wasn't informed in one day. Now, in the day of man, in the 7 days, he put it into action. But then the Bible tells us in Hebrews 9, chapter 26, verse says, for then must he have often suffered since the foundation of the world, That would have to be in Genesis 1 and 2. What was he suffering from? There was pain. There was travail. What he would create, what he wanted to create, what the outcome would be. And he would make it in such a way that he would have appreciation for it and not just make it and walk away and hope it survived, but would have enough God being God to come down every evening and check on his man. Wow, you didn't get that. You're just looking at me. I'm talking about the majesty. I'm talking about the power of all powers. I'm talking about God that doesn't have to do that. Stooped so low, if I can say that, to meet man's level. Every evening he met with Adam. And if there was no travail involved, he would have never showed up, but every Easter and every Christmas or whatever the seasons. Travail, work. Piece of the action. The water breaks. I paid a price for this child. That's the reason why you see good mothers go ballistic when their children do something wrong. And the child looks at the mother and says, "You've lost your mind." She slaps you across the cheek. And the child says, "I'm going to call my lawyer." And you say, "Call your lawyer all you want. I gave birth to you. You're not going to turn out to be a whore. You're not going to be turned out to be some drug addict. You're not going to be some incompoop. I travailed over you." And in most cases, the mother almost gives up, even to the point that she's so exhausted because she's raising these children by herself. Even though there may be a so-called man in the house, he's not travailed, so he don't care what they do. Stay out past midnight, own guns, just suck cigarettes, do what you want to do. Here's 30 bucks. Get out of my hair. But if he had travailed and she then brings to him her love and he then begins to see, "Oh, this is the price." Then he starts paying a price to support it. And it's not just a everything deal. And in every aspect of life, God is telling us there is no way that you are going to get what you need out of life, out of God, out of people, out of yourself, unless there's travail. Which brings me to, I'm going to do this just for a moment, just for a moment. Help, please forgive me on my little pet peeve here. Lazy people. You come to work late. You take the longest breaks on the job, and you're the one that calls in the most sick, and you're not sick. You went to the beach. You're lying, devil, lazy, no good. And won't do a good job because it's not your business. You don't own it. You don't have to represent. You didn't pay the price for somebody to pay your hospitalization, to pay your electricity, to work and give you. No, you didn't have to. You didn't even have to borrow the money. You didn't have to borrow the money on this church to live under a $14 million every single Sunday. Standing up here acting like everything was paid off. And then you walk and you criticize in the back lobby. You don't like this and you don't like that. You never put a dime in it anyway. And so that's all you can do is gripe about it because you never travailed. Get the heck out of here. Join you the first church of no tithe. Join you a lazy church where all they do is bowl after service on Sunday and never grow and have 50 people. It's nothing but a click. and their dialogue is not reaching the world. Their dialogue is picking on the big church that's doing something for God and criticizing everything that somebody who travailed to bring it to pass. Let me push the envelope a little farther. You go out to eat with people, you've never paid the bill. You've been out so many times, you don't even know what a bill feels like. You don't even know when the waitress hands the bill. You've never even opened it up. You don't even know how to tip a person, much less contribute. Should I help you? You tight, no good. You never travailed for the money. You never had to worry about it. You cheapskate and bloodsucker. You find people you know will pay your bill and feel good about it simply because they feel good about giving. But, oh, they have travailed when they paid that. But you just keep using it for your own goodwill or something because you have no appreciation. And then you have the audacity to get in your car and say, that was a bad meal you didn't pay for. At least you could reach in your pocket and act like you're gonna say, could I help? That would make the person say, boy, I feel good that they wanted to help. But to sit there and to stare down time after time after time, you lazy, no good, blood sucking. And then after you leave me, you'll criticize me and get to the next crowd that'll pay your bill and you'll talk about me. Because you never had to pay the price. I'm not talking about any of you. You should all be doing this. Unless you're what I'm talking about, and I would stare straight ahead and just not say nothing. Or the next time you go out to eat, you pay the bill. After hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of dollars have been paid on you and there's no appreciation. Don't even have the courtesy to put a thank you card or a text to say thank you or at Christmas time to at least buy them some M&Ms for $2.25 or whatever M&Ms cost you. You don't know the value, the appreciation of travail. In fact, I will tell you this, working is good for you. In fact, you never feel good about yourself unless you are dog tired at 5 or 6, or if you work all night in the morning, and you lay your head down, you feel good about your bones aching and your hands aching and using your mind. And you gave 8 hours of travail for Friday to get your check. You actually feel good. You know why that is? Because when God gave the curse, he says man will have to work until he sweats for his money. Woman will have to travail at childbirth. In other words, God said you had it easy. You didn't have to do any of that. But because you chose to be ease in Zion and think everything was free, you floated over and talked to the wrong party, and you tick-tocked your way over to the serpent, and you got behind closed doors on your phone, and you went in the secret place of the garden where you thought nobody knew about it, even though you canceled history, and you thought you had erased everything, the conversation started up. And Satan said, your God is a liar. To tell you to think that anything would happen through all of this obedience, which is travail, is stupid. And then you know what happened. Man went into travail, and God transferred the travail to man. Because it was God's travail to keep this whole thing into orbit. We're the ones travailing over global green or whatever they're trying to tell us. why it's hot here and cold there and there's no water here and all of that. And we're all saying, oh, my, we got to do something about it. We got to do something about it. And God said, go right ahead because, you know what? I travailed to give it to you. It's time for you to travail to try to keep it. And if you'd have listened to me in the first spot, we wouldn't be in this position. You would have never had to work. You would have never had to earn anything. I gave you everything. There was just one little tree, but you had to say, I want to play around with one little tree. The 99 couldn't suffice you. You had to play one time to commit adultery, one time to lie, one time to steal, just once. Because you want to skip the travail part. Now, this is all good. It's not bad. It sounds like, oh my God, do we have to live through the life of travail? No, no. I'm trying to tell you that travail is good. Because it only lasts when you're in a moment of travail on something you're pursuing, whether whatever you're trying to birth, a dream, or you're trying to achieve, or where you're trying to go, that when you give, when God strikes your water, and that thing breaks, and you feel like, where is God? Because you're not moving on a date. You can't go anywhere. You're rocking this big old dream and you're in sweat and you are just irritable, etc. Because right before the moment before the child comes, after you travail, oh, it's not a good moment. It seems like it's not selling. It's not going. Nothing is working out. God is not answering my prayer. What in the heck is wrong with him? And what has got into my children? And what is going on with this house? It's leaking. The commode is run over. And the bills are 3 months behind. Oh, my God. What in the world have I been believing? It's a signal. You're about to give birth to the very thing you have been believing for. You got impregnated by a word from God. And God said, I'm going to heal you with, I'm going to heal your cancer. But it doesn't mean you have to not go through burning your body up, losing your hair, going to the doctor, go through radiation, going through all this stuff. God, why in the world can't you heal me right now? Because if you go through travail and the healing comes, you'll have a deeper appreciation for what I do for you in your life. I gotta quit here, but I'm... The Bible says that in Zion or in the church, you become at ease in Zion. The Bible says, if you're not careful, you become with familiarity. And with a breed of tolerance of sin and temptation. And you're in the church or you're in the kingdom or you're on God's road and God's got a plan for you. And all of a sudden, you become ease in Zion. And one of the signals of ease in Zion is, first step is you back away from prayer because it's just too hard to pray. Don't tell me you pray at home because you don't pray at home. You start backing away from your Bible, church attendance. It's tough to come to church. You know all these people that are here tonight? We can line them up and say, how was it coming to church tonight? Oh my God, today I just went through some stuff. I said I wasn't going to go. I just said, I'm going to pull in the driveway. I have just had it. Not with the church. But not Wednesday night. I'll just wait till Sunday. Every one of you here had to fight to get here. You had to make up in your mind and say, shut up, flesh. I'm in the mood to travail because I understand if I travail, if I press toward, if I fight the good fight, if I help me now. Something will happen on Wednesday night. And I want to tell all of you, it is going to happen when you walk out that door. Something is going to happen because you have been in travail. What does this travail of the church, what does it mean? Well, when you travail, you are strong, unwavering faith. Why is travail necessary? Well, there's no labor, there'll be no profit. No labor, no profit. Pastor, what? Do you realize how much work you're doing? Yeah, listen to my voice. I'm wearing it out. Stripping my vocal cords. Not here tonight, last night. Acting like Pilate, showing the actor what to do, Malachi and I. What accusation do you have bring against this man? I don't have any mic on. Yelling at the high priest, quit talking where nobody can hear you. Lift up your voice. You know, I'm directing. I'm not pastoring, I'm directing. You should join the play and see how I direct. You think this is difficult, you should get in this play. I don't like the way you're yelling at me. I don't like the way you tell me what to do. I don't like that, preacher, pastor. I don't think I'll be in it next year. But you will like when they give you a standing ovation and say, wow, we've never seen nothing like it. Then you have to look at me and say, thank you for the travail. The singers have to come an extra night. That's travail. They come an extra night. The reason why, you see the singers here, they pay the price. Don't sit there and criticize them and say, ah, they're cool up on that stage. You got a mic. They're cool over there. They're standing right there. She thinks she's really something. Well, she has a right to think that she's something because she has busted her schedule to get here while you sat and watched your Netflix. And enjoyed as the three worlds burn or as the world turns, whatever it is. Or whatever. They are travailing. I know you think it's very exciting, but it's not exciting to pick up horse poop. Horses poop. Just like little dogs. But their poop is big. Somebody has got to go behind them and scoop the poop. I know, every one of you. Not me. Not me. But did you know there are excited people in this production who have a team of people that while the play's going on, in one hand, they got the scoop, and in the other hand, they got the broom. And they can't wait for the horse to poop so they can rush out and get it up before you even know it or somebody steps in it. And for them, it's travail to smell it and then to get rid of it and to make sure that you all are happy so that the poop is not in the middle of the auditorium. And for us to have animals, people, we have to travail. And so we ask people to get involved. Would you mind being a pooper scooper? And let me tell you, those people that are pooper scoopers, I love them because they're the happiest people in the whole bunch. I mean, you just can't. You think I'm crazy? Come and help us poop scoop Thursday night. Alice, has a blind son. Deaf. He can't wait till we do a production. It's a production in that garage. The first garage has got an electric button. He's blind. He can't hear. He's got special hearing aids. You almost got a scream in his ear. He knows where that button is. He knows right where the play is. He knows when the horses should go in and go out. And he gets up off the seat and makes his way 40 feet to the other button. And you sit with two eyes and good ears. That's called travail. Because if the doors don't open, the horses of the task cannot get in here. We're travailing. It's travailing for me to be behind the scenes trying to, direct 300 or 400. I'm back here. Anybody been with me? I dance with them when they dance on stage. Oh, I'm just behind the curtain. I'm cheering them on. I take my Dolce Gabbanas and just step everywhere and all kinds of, I don't have time to look to see if my shoes are good enough. And you see me with my clothes, it don't matter what kind of suit I got on. I'm moving. I'm travailing. I'm going to make sure that God's gospel gets out to some people so there can be a bursting in the saints. Let me tell you about, and I'm going to finish this, but the consequences of being at ease in Zion. The Bible talks about ease in Zion. The church will decrease. Many are eased in Zion, the church. Though in the church, they're really not of the church. The characteristics of their lives are not those proper to the sincere believer. The meaning of ease in Zion, many, when you're eased in Zion, you're preoccupied. Spiritual things ought to be first and the best. And it should grab our attention. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things shall be added. But ease in Zion is not him, it's about me. Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation, Matthew 26:24. When we're in ease in Zion, we become careless. We eat, drink, marry, and give in marriage. Luke 17:27 says they did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. The householder relaxes his watchfulness. That's no big deal. God, church, whatever. And Matthew 24:43 says, but know this, that the good man of the house had known and would watch the thief would have come. He would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. You need to know if a drug dealer's coming into your house. You need to know if he's ever been drunk. Well, he's cute and he's popular and he's on the football team and his parents are rich. I don't care how rich the parents are. Dude comes in messing with your daughter, or opposite. Here comes this girl. Who is she? Oh, she's popular and her parents are this and that. They got money. Money nor popularity does not stop a sin or a curse that could be in that individual. Now, I wonder about you, mother down here. You have five sons, right? Four. Seems like you got 10. They're everywhere. I mean, it's just... Those boys are something. I would not want to come home to this mother and break the rules at her house. Because I can tell this mother watches her house. And ain't no girl going in there to get in the bedroom and shut the door. I guarantee you, son, you keep that girl at the kitchen table. and I'll be in the next room listening. Stupid parents. Stupid. You don't care about your kids. You're so desperate because you're not in travail. If you're in travail, you get on your knees and say, God, I want these kids to be blessed. I want them to have the very best. God, I want to tell you, I want to sacrifice my life for these kids. God, if the devil is in these men or in these girls, run them out of here in the name of Jesus. Oh, God, don't let my kids be cursed. The ease in Zion, the Bible talks about five wise, five foolish virgins, and the five wise. The five wise, they kept their land strength. They kept going to church. They kept praying. And the five foolish, they led out of church, and they didn't trim their lamps, and they didn't get any oil, because you get oil when you come to church and trim your lamps so you get oil. And the Bible said the bridegroom came, and the five foolish went to the five wise. And they said, we need some oil. Please give us some oil. And the wise said to them in so many words, I didn't never see you travail to get oil. It took me prayer meetings and worship services and giving my tithes. That's how I got this oil here. And besides, the only way I can get into eternal life is this oil. I travailed, I believe, when I didn't have a dime. And God's word said, give it to me. And I said, no, if I do it. And then I went home and I thought I lost my mind because I gave the last, what was I thinking, the last $10? You walk in the door and you go for a peanut butter jar and it's empty, but you take the knife and you keep scraping it, and you're kind of shocked that you got a whole sandwich. And you didn't know God sent an angel to put an extra scoop in that because he was getting ready, because you travailed. God will never let you suffer. He will never, ever, ever let you go without. He's a God more than enough, and the blessing will come. Travail's good. If you're going through it, it's only a signal. Your water's about to break. And something good's getting ready to happen. If you're going through some trouble, if you got some bad news, if things are not working out, it's all right. You came tonight and God said, that's the way to go. Keep travailing. This is my last story. Cheryl, you can play. That'll signal then that I'm finishing up. I might not, Cheryl, but you just act like I'm finished. I am. I don't want anybody to feel sorry for me, because this is not the reason why I'm saying it, but ever since I was a little boy, I would say I'm going to build the biggest church, you know, in those days of the world. Then my ministry got going, and many of you don't know this, but about 1988, the Jimmy syndrome, what I called Jimmy Swaggart, there was a setback there, and it was a setback with Jimmy Baker, and the whole world kind of went crazy there. Christian television was coming on the scene, and people were excited about sending money to PTL, and people who are preaching on television, which is good. And all of a sudden, things begin to go upside down, and Jim Baker was arrested and had to go to prison. Which really, he didn't have to go to prison. But because he was a Christian, and he preached what he preached, they took it out on him. Because what he did wasn't prison worthy. It was penalty worthy, you know, the fine and certain things, but not that bad. Anybody in a situation will tell you, right? So about 1988 or 89, they called me. I'm pastoring Griffith. Church is starting to flourish. I came in 85, 84. And the church is starting to grow. We knocked out the back wall, turned the church around, and people began to come. and it's gone quite quickly. My voice began to somehow get edge across the United States, and I began to fly Monday, Tuesday, get back here Wednesday, fly out Thursday, Friday, and I was gone preaching somewhere in this country the nights that we didn't have service. One day, Philip Cameron said to me, "Steve, could you come down and help PTL? It's going to go bankrupt. We moved off the campus. Jim is in jail. But they still have some things here. And you, could you come and help me ask the people to support it so that the ministry could keep going forward, even though it's changed different hands?" And I didn't know any better. I had never watched PTL. You got to understand, I didn't have a TV till I was 30-some years of age. Never went to a movie. Never went to a sporting event. Never went to a dance. When I would try for football, I would make the team. My dad would make me quit because we had church on Friday night and the games were on Friday night. I would go out for basketball to make the basketball team. My dad made me quit because basketball at Morton and Maryville was on church nights. I was coordinated enough, and every teacher that I had in gym in my high school gave me C minuses and called me, "You're a quitter. You're a quitter." And I would never tell them, "You don't know my deal." My dad is the fastest man alive with his belt. And I'm not scared of God, I'm scared of my dad. My dad with me with a belt. He didn't put me in the corner and say, "Time out." He didn't even know what that was. I didn't even know there was a corner in my house till years later. That's a corner. He whipped me. He pulled my pants down and whipped me. Did he abuse you? No, he whipped me. Did it hurt? Oh, did it hurt. And then he would do this to me every time he whipped me. "Come here, son." "What?" "I was human. I wanted to hit him so bad. I'm going to run away. This goes through my mind. I'm running away. Tonight, I'm running away. I'm sneaking out the basement window, and I'm running away." I didn't get that far because where would I go? He said, "Come over here, son." I come over there. "What?" "Put your arms around me. Tell me you love me." And I wanted to say, "Just keep beating me. Just keep beating me. I ain't doing that." And my dad would make me, "This is true. Tell me you love me, son." After he beat me, my butt is red. I probably deserved. I had ADD, so that was before anybody knew what ADD was. And I didn't do anything really bad. I never cussed around my dad. Whatever I did in those days, because he asked me one time, "Do you cuss, son?" "Of course not, Dad." But to be accepted at school, I learned the F word and the S word. Used it quite often because I enjoyed it. What the F? I'm a sixth grader. But I want them to know I'm not a Christian. I'm totally embarrassed. Especially if they was to ever find out that my dad was a preacher. Oh, that was worse. Then let me tell you what was really the worst. Because I went to school with all Catholics in public school. And if they found out you're a Christian, and then if they found out you were one of those people who lifted your hands and clapped your hands, they branded you as a holy roller. And God knows, I was so embarrassed going to school. I didn't have all what you guys got, Christian schools. I'm in public school. And I was embarrassed. I was embarrassed. And my dad, so I didn't have television until I was 32. My first movie, I think, was 33, and I saw Platoon with one of the brothers in the church, and we got halfway through it, and I told him, I said, "I didn't die. God didn't kill me. And I'm enjoying Platoon on a bigger screen. And it dawned on me, what's the difference between a 25-foot screen and a little screen? They just have popcorn in the front. I couldn't. But I was taught movie theaters are the devil. For you that lived here long enough, you knew on Ridge Road where Jedi's is, there used to be an outdoor theater there. Oh, anybody know that? Klein Avenue? I was 16. You found me parked on the side, just intrigued with that big movie, making sure my dad didn't find out that I was watching Drive-In. I loved when my dad went down Klein Avenue. I would stare at that big old screen. He couldn't do nothing about it. There were times when my dad would say, boys, are you looking at that? Absolutely not, Dad. That's where I was raised. And I was called by this ministry. And anybody that knew the PTL days, they were taking about $120 million a year. They built a water park. It's great what Jim did. It was really kind of a Christian Disneyland. And Jim was a great man. In fact, I was the first one when Jim got out of prison. We were the first church to have Jim preach again. That's right. You gotta clap your hands. That's all right. And it got in the papers. I wanted Northwest Indiana and all the Chicagoland area to know I wasn't ashamed to forgive. And since that time, Jim has done great down in the Ozarks. Good friend of mine, done great, and he's done great. He's I can't believe all the things he's done. And when Jimmy Swaggart was in trouble, I went to get Jimmy. I brought Jimmy to the church. I helped him get back on his feet. Today, he's the biggest thing on television. They're doing great. The whole family's doing great. That's kind of personal. And so they called me. You have to understand that there was such a shock in the body of Christ nationwide. The phones had stopped and the offerings and the money of support had stopped. Now, I had never been, as I just told you, never been to PTL. I did not even see it. I did not know it. So when they got me on the set, Philip Cameron said, whatever you feel. And I didn't know you were supposed to sit on the couch. I jumped up from the couch and started moving all over the studio. And I went in and out the lights, and the directors were saying, keep them in the lights, keep them in the lights, keep them in the lights. And I'm running all over the studio. And the phone started ringing all over the nation. When I got home, Philip Cameron said, they want you back next week. We haven't had this response in 2 years. I went back the next week and same thing happened. We want you back the next week. On the third week, the board that had assumed all of PTL. By the way, this is in several books that people, preachers have written. And they came to me and said, we're going to give this to you. You're the next Jim Baker. So I came home and told Melody, hey Mel, I'm the next Jim Baker. We're going to Charlotte. We're going to reach the world. We're only reaching 1,000 people. In one time that I've been on, Mel, I'm reaching literally 800 to 1.5 million at one time. Why should we just reach 1,000 when I can reach 1,000,000 and then I could build my amphitheater and I could influence my gifts? You know what Melody said? You go down there, you'll go to hell. You'll get an ego, you'll go on an ego trip. You're too much in the flesh. I'm not going with you, you're staying here. To me, that was travail. The whole world was in my hands. I was the next voice. No, there's no doubt about it. Remember that, James? I see James out there. Remember that? He'll remember. And Melody chewed me out. She was more spiritual then. She still is. And she saved my life. Now, it's gone on, it's done great things, etc. Let me show you how this works. So Rich Wilkerson, it's in his book, you should get it. It's in the bookstore. He writes a chapter on it, I didn't even know he wrote on it. So the denomination he was in found out that they wanted me. So a big denomination calls Rich. It says, Rich, they got a guy named Steve Munsey that they want to turn it over to. Rich, we're sending you in there. You take it, you confiscate it. You make sure he doesn't get it. I didn't know anything about that. All I knew was Mel, he said, you're not going. They gave it to Rich Wilkerson. He writes it in his book. Yeah, you can read it. You can go back there and read it. He writes the whole truth. And they moved it and it went bankrupt under his leadership. And one day we're sitting at the restaurant because I just got done preaching and helping him, and the church was exploding in Miami under a tent and I was helping him. And he starts breaking down and crying at a restaurant. He said, you should hate me. I said, what for? Steve, I stole PTL from you. My denomination got behind me to make sure, because you weren't in that denomination, to get it from you. I smiled at Rich and said, I wasn't going anyway, because Melly told me I'd be going to hell if I took that. You read it in the book. It's in the book. It's Rich Wilkerson's book. He writes a chapter on it. And he couldn't believe I was his friend. And he thought I'd be mad at him. And let me just tell everybody that maybe some people have said no to save you from yourself while you're travailing for your miracle. And it's the right no. Or it's the right. So that meant I had to come back here and build. And I said, okay, then I'm going to give everything I have. No money. We had no rich people then. We got a few rich people now. They're here tonight, thank God, because they'll give. I'll make them give if you don't give. But then no rich people. $20, $40, I'm almost done. $30. Sometimes it'd be $500 to build this. But I did not know I would lose my life in building this. I did not know that when John Jacobs came to me and said, you're dying, I'm getting you on an airplane right now and you're going to Palm Springs to see a specialist. He flew me there on his own money. John Jacobs was head of the power team at the time, and I didn't know I looked so bad. And when I got in the doctor's office and he went through all the blood tests, he says, sir, you're 40 years older than you should be. You're on the verge of a stress collapse and you are going to be out. What are you doing? I didn't use the word travail, but I was in travail. The town had come against me, and last night, I forgot about this, but I wanted to tell you this before we go. They wouldn't let us in the building. The building was finished. We had about 14 things we had to get accomplished, and it was like, electrical plugs, and we got it all done, and they left town Wednesday, and Easter was the following Sunday, and we did everything we possibly could to please the town at that time. They wouldn't let us in on Easter, and they told me, you walk in that church, you'll never get a permit, and we'll make sure and we'll shut it down. And we had our first Easter service outside, underneath the carport. And it was cold. And as a train parked out there blowing its horn. And people sat in their cars on Easter Sunday morning. And I'd laid down my life dying trying to get into this building because I was travailing. Now there were other people that were travailing with me and they knew how bad it was. No money. On Wednesday night, I would go into the offering. Remember that? Terry and James, remember that? Tommy Davis would count the change. We count the pennies in those days. I never knew pennies could look so good. And I'll never forget that the town said one final thing. You'll not get in until you get a parking lot. The first level of the parking lot would be $500,000, and we had no money in the bank, so we're not giving you no more money. You got to understand, there was no, there was not this in the back where we built $7 million for the children's ministry. The upstairs wasn't done. The dome wasn't done. It's just this auditorium. We had no, and of course, we had the stage. And I didn't know what to do. I had no one to go to. I had no money I could borrow. I didn't know what I was going to do. They had kept us out in Easter. And Terry, and they said, you stay out of that building. Don't you dare bring your people in. And Dr. Terry Harmon reminded me, and I said, do you remember what you did, Pastor? We were rehearsing, you remember? I said, what do you mean? He said, remember you gave out rags to all the actors. And you told all the actors, you come to work tonight, not to practice. On your way down the aisles, just start rubbing the pews. Here, the ones you're sitting in, to go up on the stage. And if anybody from the town comes, pull out your rag. I said, I'm here to work, because workers could work. So I had a rag ministry going on. And if somebody walked in, they would wave their rags and say, we're working. And I was in Marion on national television. And when I get in front of the camera, you know, nobody knows, nobody in the world knows what's going on. And I'm ministering worldwide, et cetera. And the owner of the station, TCT, Garth Brooks, sat beside me and said, how's it going, Pastor? You know what I said? It's going great. You know, it's really tough to say that when you're going through travail. You're about to lose your mind. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You want to belch out. It's horrible. I'm never going to do this again. I wish I never was called in the ministry. I wish I would go to Hollywood. I wish I'd have changed, you know, did a different profession. I was so pregnant. I wasn't 9 months. I was 12 months. And no water was breaking. The doctor said I was 30, 40 years older than I was. I was under tremendous stress. No money. It was horrible. And in my travail of agony of that moment, he said to me, do you need anything? I said, yeah, well, we need $500,000 for the parking lot, and then we can move in. Well, we just have to pray about it. Don't you hate that when people, we'll pray about it. Won't you do something to me about it? I got too many people saying, we'll pray about it. At the end of the night, after I ministered to the whole world from TCT headquarters and on national television, I was about to walk out of the studio when Garth, the president, said, Pastor Steve, come here. He handed me an envelope. Now, you have to know that when I get honorariums, or I go all over the world, they give me honorariums. And I don't charge anybody. I don't do what these preachers are doing now, these singers. Because these singers, they say, I need $20,000, I need $30,000. Preachers will even say, I want to come to church, but it'll cost you $35,000. And you learn real quick, oh, great, they're popular. Bishop so-and-so, wow. And they come and it costs you $60,000, and the offering's only $20,000. And it takes me 6 months to pay it off. While everybody says, look at us, we had this, that. And then they say, can we have them again? And I say, no. I don't charge people. I'll never charge anybody. How much you charge, Pastor Steve? I don't charge anything. A man called me from Washington, D.C. today. He said, please, would you come and speak for me? What night? I can't do it Wednesday or Sunday. What night? He tells me in the night. I said, hey, let me tell you something, Pastor. How big is your congregation? Well, we have about 2,000 people. Hey, I'm going to tell you something. I'm not coming for your money, so don't give me an offering. Just give me a nice room. Feed me a good meal, because I'm not coming for your money. You should have heard that, Pastor. What would you do? What would you repeat that? Would you say that again? Then I used to do that. When I get an honorarium in the envelope, I actually put it in my suit, wherever I'm in the world, never open it, and I bring it home and I give it to Melody. Never open it. She'll tell you, never open it. You ought to see some preachers that we have here and singers. They can't wait to get to the green room, to get in the bathroom, to open it up, see what they give. And you'll find out if it was enough when they come out. Oh, man, you're a great. Or, I got to go. I'm sick to my stomach because we didn't give them enough. That's the game. That's the game. And they don't know how we travail to even have them. They don't even know that we didn't make budget. But you didn't know that because we wanted the very best for you. You don't know that. Oh, you look at my car, you look at me now. You say, oh, yeah, this and that. Yeah, you should have been there when my water broke. You should have been there when I lost my mind. You should have been there when I missed week after week paycheck. Right, Terry Owens? Wave your hand. While you stood out and said, give me my check. Pain. So I put the envelope, I'm in it now, but I put the envelope in my suit coat. Never looked at it. In those days I had a plane, and so they would pay for my plane, and they paid for my gas, and they would pay for my pilot, so I could get back and forth, because I started not doing commercial because I couldn't get back in time to preach to you on Wednesday night. And I made a commitment on Wednesday night. For you folks, I'd come back to 400 people when I could preach to thousands of people. And the reason why I did that, because I was in travail to get all of you here tonight on a Wednesday night later in life. All of you whippersnappers, you preacher boys, you all want that pulpit. You say, well, I get up there, I can really preach, I can really turn them on. You'd flop on your nose simply because you have no travail in your life. You don't pray, you don't have a clue. Ain't nobody interested in your spit and speed. Spit. Speed and spit. Speed and spit. So I laid that check on the counter. Melody got up. I think the plane got in. I got in 2:00, flew into Griffith Airport. I think I told her I gotta go up in the morning. I gotta head for another city tomorrow, baby. I heard a scream and a yell at 2:30, 3:00 in the morning. And I thought Candy would jump out the window or something had happened. And she was screaming, Steve! 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 And I get out of bed and say, what is it? Who gave you this $500,000? You don't have to clap because you didn't travail in those days. I understand. And it's easy just to say it. And a little note written on the bottom. Whenever you get it, you can just pay the ministry back. That was the deal. I want to tell you, everything we got, everything that you see, Kent, what God's getting ready to do. Did you know that Kent's building next to the United Center? You know that's going to be a $40 million building? Do you know that the city the other night approved it? Do you know that God has already paid for the $8 million land? Do you know he has raised nearly $17 million? Do you know when he sells his building, it will almost be debt free? And it will be the first church ever built downtown in 100 years. 100 years. Talk about brand new. That's all because of this. The equestrian center is ready to go. Plans are done. We're looking for the tomorrow. We're looking for the man that can run it, as far as build it. We're all ready to go. We've ordered the building, $2.2 million. It's bigger than this building. Both buildings we got here. It's bigger. And God provided. Somebody in this church 12 years ago that didn't have anything started paying their tithes, never paid their tithes before in their life. They started listening to the word. They started giving their tithes. And they didn't have very much. They had hardly nothing. They got baptized, filled with the Holy Ghost, joined the classes, kept tithing. 12 years later, they walk up to me and say, Pastor, the Lord has blessed us. And when you look at the check and you say, oh my God, $3.7 million. Pay for that building over there. When are you going to write me a $3 million? And I prayed for their company and laid hands. They'll tell you the whole story. And God has blessed them. Right here. And they didn't come from another church. Right here. Under this anointing. And there are many of you that are wealthy, and many of you are going to be wealthy because God has raised you up. And I've preached too long. Everybody say travail. So I've been 30 minutes too long. That's called travail. We won't do this next week. But I want to tell you that whatever you're going through, it's all right. Because what you're going through, you're about to birth the miracle in your life. Okay, everybody, turn to somebody and say, I want to give to God tonight. Say that. I want to give to God tonight. You take your phones out as you begin to give the Wednesday night offering. If you need an envelope, the ushers are in the aisles. Come on, ushers. I'm a little bit over time. We got to hurry here, but I'm going to tell you. How many's enjoyed the word of God? How many's faith has increased? How many believe for good things? Take your phones out. If you need an envelope, lift your hands. I need one. Somebody rush down here. I need one. If you'd like to do it by envelope, you can do it. Make sure your prayer request card, purple, that was given to you, fill it out so I can nail it on the cross beginning next Wednesday night. The cross is coming down. Thank you. I'll take the pen too. Thank you. So you grab an envelope, balcony, you, all of you that are watching as you give, and then every person that's given by phone, you're so faithful. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for every giver. Thank you, Lord, for every giver. Thank you for the offering. Thank you for every giver. Thank you for every giver. Everybody say, I love to give.
I love to give.
That's it. I love to give.
I love to give.
You're doing it by phone right now. All of you that are doing it by phone, as soon as you do it by phone, please stand. All of you that are doing it by envelope or as the... Please stand. Please stand. Please stand as the container is coming by. Please stand. All of you that are not going to take anything out, please stand. All of you that are not going to rob, you're not going to rob anybody, please stand. As we give, sing a little bit, just a little bit.
Thank you, Jesus. You're the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
Stretch your hands toward the offering, please. Everybody stretch your hands and say, oh God, come.
Oh God,
we love you.
We love you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the travail.
For the travail.
For when Zion travails.
When Christians travail.
It brings forth the miracles.
It brings forth the miracles.
My dreams.
My dreams.
Money.
Money.
Answers to prayer.
Answers to prayer.
My children.
My children.
My family.
My family.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Everybody lift your hand, right hand up, please, if you can. Thank you, guys. I pronounce a blessing upon everyone because when I came out here tonight and the Lord gave me this word, He said, tell the people who are going through something, it will be over by Easter. That in this season, I'm going to do a mighty work. Now I'm going to show you something. You're going to see it in Israel. I pray for the peace. Now I'm believing there's going to be peace, ceasefire by Easter. Somebody believe that with me. Something's going to happen to Ukraine, and China is not going to invade Taiwan. And God is going to answer. So if you're going through anything, you're going through anything, it's a sign that weeping endureth for the night, but joy is coming in the morning. So everybody with your right hand up, I pronounce this word of God upon you that God has spoken to say, whatever you're going through, it's all right. It's a sign you're giving birth to something incredible. And you need to be congratulated. And you need to know God's got it all under control. But He wants you to go through a little something of travail so you will appreciate when He blesses you. Unbelievable. Now everybody, in this last moment in this earth, thank you for being a little extra long. We'll be this week, next Wednesday. Clap your hands and just shout hallelujah. 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 Somebody's water's going to break tonight. Somebody's going to get a miracle this week. Turn around and tell somebody, you are going to get a miracle. God bless you. See you Super Bowl Sunday.
You heard how everything kind of slows down, slow motion time. You can imagine, you know, in warfare, as I spoke tonight, in warfare, when the battle, as I was referring to Napoleon, watching that movie, watching two nations collide. In the moments before, it got real slow. Time almost stopped. People who knew, I probably am going to die. I'm going to live. Who's going to win? This is what happens, as I spoke tonight, in your future. And your future is always in that moment of travail. But when Zion travails, the word says, you shall bring forth. And there is a bringing forth, I believe. That's the reason why there's so many things happening right now in our world. Bringing forth peace in the Middle East. Bringing forth peace in Ukraine. Bringing forth the peace in China. Bringing forth, but right now it's travail, it's pain, the water is broken, there's some screaming, there's some not so good things to look upon as we're giving birth, in that case of nations, peace in your life, the next level, the healing, the believing God. I'm excited, and I really do believe this is a very unique season. And next week, everybody listen to this. Next week, we're giving a nail. It's tradition on Ash Wednesday at Family Christian Center. We give a nail, and it's a red nail. It's painted red to remind us for the next 50 days of Jesus took nails in His hands. Number two, every person will be anointed. Now, I know the Catholic Church, they put ashes on people's head, and it's a time of Lent season, as they call it, to give up something, and that's fine. But we're going to anoint with oil to believe that the next 50 days there's going to be a tremendous miracle, that God is about to bring a powerful resurrection, and what is dead is going to come back. We're going to do that next Wednesday night. We also are going to give a purple cloth. Now, these purple cloths are cut, and they're so beautifully, beautifully done. We have several people who, when they cut this purple cloth, it is so accurate and so beautiful, the presentation. Then all of these cloths are personally anointed. They're dipped in oil. Everyone will receive a cloth. Now, this is very scriptural. This is not a gimmick. This is not something man made up. It's very, very scriptural, and sometimes we don't use it enough. But the Bible says when a cloth is prayed for, as it was brought to Paul with handkerchiefs and aprons, the Bible says they were anointed and they could take it and evil spirits would leave, and they could lay it on people that were sick and they would be healed. That's going to happen next Wednesday, because it's Ash Wednesday. The cross is going to come down for the first time in 2024, and we are going to begin to put our prayer requests, and I encourage you to get your prayer request in. Even you tonight, you can say, here's my prayer request, so we're ready to go to nail your prayer request on the cross. Beginning on Ash Wednesday, we will let down the purple. It is going to be a powerful anointed service. It's one of the Wednesday nights of the year. You know, several, maybe three or four or five Wednesday nights that are so powerful that really lunges people when they come into advancement of their life. God just kind of takes them from right where they are, because people are so obedient, they're so hungry, that God says, I'm going to take you from where you are and I'm going to move you quickly. I'm going to do a quick work. Suddenly, I'm going to do something that would take gradually to get there. So next Wednesday night is going to be great. Also, I want to tell you about Jesus of Nazareth. In a moment, we're going to end with, you know, a trailer of Jesus of Nazareth, and the rehearsals are going great. We have more people in this production than we've ever had in this 50th year. We're working every night. People are being trained. Horses are being trained. The set is being worked on. We have some brand new scenes, never before seen in 50 years. And at Jesus of Nazareth here at Family Christian Center, there is a readjustment of the set that we're going to surprise the audience. When you see it, you will say, wow, what an incredible addition to the story of Jesus of Nazareth. So in the 50th year, everybody get your tickets. Everybody tell somebody. All of you, listen, all of you that favor to watch Family Christian Center, you are faithful. You don't live here. Let me tell you something. Get ready in the month of March to bus here, to drive here, to fly here. Be here on a Saturday to see the production, and on Sunday to be with us in service. You can make that happen any weekend in March. And the very first weekend in March is going to be the opening and the premiere of Jesus of Nazareth, the 2nd of March. So you could come in on Friday, you come in on Saturday, stay over Sunday. Some of you live in Texas, Florida, East Coast, wherever you might live in the world, fly in. Last night at rehearsal, I was shocked when someone told me there are 15 people, and for the last 4 or 5 years, these 15 people have gotten on airplanes and flown here and have watched Jesus of Nazareth from Los Angeles. I didn't even know that. Faithfully, they buy tickets, get on an airplane, they stay all night to come and see Jesus of Nazareth. Well, I'm excited to tell you, get your tickets now, because they're going very quickly, and I'm so excited. And of course, I want to tell everybody, Sunday is Super Bowl Sunday, and wait till you hear the message that I've got for you and what we're going to do Sunday. It's going to be spectacular. Super Bowl Sunday. You don't want to miss that. Friday morning prayer. God is going to move in a very, very special way. Well, What can I say? But you may feel like things are moving slow. You may feel like things are not happening in your life. That's all for a reason. Travail has started. The water has broken. The miracle is being birthed. You've been carrying it. You've been frustrated. You've been wondering, what am I going to do? How am I going to navigate? And this is the season that God says, it's time. So today, I'm excited that you were with us. You know, the people gave tonight, you have the opportunity to give too. And I am so appreciative that the people that give and to support Family Christian Center is just outstanding. The moment you give, you will get a special message from me. So if you go online and say, Pastor, I want to give. I want the kingdom to expand. You can do that. Father, I thank you for every Wednesday night watcher. Thank you, Lord, because there's a breakthrough. There is something getting ready to happen in the next 50 days, Lord, of their life. And it all begins tonight in this season, this week. So in the name of Jesus, bring us back together by way of streaming. And Lord, thank you that the church, the people that are watching, connected, we claim as the church in Jesus' name. Now I'm going to say amen, but when I go off, they're going to play the trailer of Jesus and as you want to watch that because it is exciting. We're just a few weeks from opening. God bless you, and remember, yes, you can.
I am the resurrection, and I am the life. Father, open their eyes so that they may see your glory.